and welcome to First Chair Fantasy. I'm Lucy, and joining me in the second chair today is Ali.
Hello!
And we today are going to be looking at the fantasy world of Tamriel in Skyrim.
Yay!
The Elder Scrolls series. This is not technically a book. It has book-like qualities. Yeah. There are plenty of books in it that you can
read. Hundreds.
So basically Ali is going to be playing the game whilst we blather all over it. And we're just going to be discussing the nature of the world that is presented to us in Skyrim. It is the fifth in a long series of fantasy RPGs. None of the others either of us have played.
Nope.
I believe.
Apart from the newer one.
Oh, of course, yes. Which we will also be talking briefly about Elder Scrolls Online. And yes, that will make us sad, I'm sure. But yes, Ali, so if you want to press go...
Yes, so I'm going to load up my save file. I've literally just created my character, walked down to Riverwood, and I know that that's when the story starts to kick off. So yeah. I thought I'll stop there, and that's where we can start this playthrough.
Something you don't often get in fantasy worlds is the chance of glitches and bugs. this is the brand new remastered version of Skyrim 5 for the PlayStation 4. I don't know what the original looked like for the PlayStation, so... This is very pretty.
It is, yes. It does look better. I've seen better games on the PS4, but it looks good. It still looks very good.
Yeah. This is a five-year-old game now.
Yes, and for that, I think it deserves respect. I mean, things like hair
and
animation are not great. I'm currently in the inn in Riverwood, and there's Sven beating on a drum, looking very cool and hippie.
We should say that we are going to attempt to put up a video playthrough of this hour.
I've never exported video from the PS4
so we don't know if it's going to work.
No.
So you may have the option of watching this in glorious videogram and seeing what we're blathering on about. Just in case that doesn't happen, we are going to describe exactly what we're seeing as we see.
So apologies if it did work and our very tedious descriptions go
now
on.
Now that is an odd... What is that?
Those are the masks. I only actually, in my previous playthrough on the Xbox 360, I only ever uncovered two of them, I think.
Yeah.
And they give you different advantages.
Is that like the Daedric Prince type things? Are they?
Possibly. Ooh, I'm really bad at mythology in big games like this.
This is something we actually want to talk about because, as we said, Skyrim is... Game 5 of the Elder Scrolls series. Mm-hmm. The first Elder Scrolls game was called Arena and came out in 1994.
Wow.
And I watched some gameplay of it earlier today in preparation. It's worse than Wolfenstein. Original Wolfenstein in its gameplay. And was originally supposed to be just some sort of combat game. You'd go to various arenas and fight to be the champion. And then that apparently someone like lost control of the game developers and that turned into a massive sprawling RPG that meant they plotted out the entire continent and you could travel from city to city on the continent and go to various places, talk to various characters, and it turned into a full RPG experience. That had, I think what it says is, mediocre success but became a cult hit. So they made the second one, which is called Daggerfall.
Cool.
And apparently in Daggerfall, the game world was half the size of Great Britain.
Wow, really?
Yeah, mostly procedurally generated.
Wow.
With a few kind of set towns that were the places you actually had to go to complete the plot. But apparently there are some estimates is there's like 750,000 inhabitants in that game.
Whoa,
NPCs and people that you can walk around. Again, it was shipped in an almost incomplete state from what I can gather. It was buggy, it was horrible. But the plot line was clearly compelling enough for them to then go on and do Morrowind, which is the first one I'd ever heard of.
Yes, that was sort of the first big hit of the series, wasn't it?
That was the first one that you would recognise as now a Scrolls game, I think. With like, you know, the weird first-person perspective with you can see both hands and you can run around and you cast spells by waving your hands in front of you and things.
I'm stood staring at the face of Lucan Valerius, who is in the trading post in Riverwood. I remember when I played through before, there's a quest to do with a claw, golden claw. So I expect
which seems an awful lot more important than I think it actually ends up being.
Yes, when this is the first quest I ever got when I first played this, and I thought, oh, this is the big plot.
I think the first time I played it, I actually completed the quest before I came into this trader. I just didn't bother doing the plot bit of the plot and just wandered off, and there's like, oh, there's an exciting thing up on the hill. I'll go see what's up there. If you go through there, you get this weird gold amulet thing.
Yeah.
And you come back here and he goes, oh, someone's stolen my golden amulet. And you go, what, this one? And that's it. I find interesting because the idea of plotting in a game means that, particularly in an Elder Scrolls game, which are sort of well known for their weird free play, you can solve the quests in any order sort of gameplay, it's got to be very difficult to write it in a way that it makes sense.
Definitely,
And write enough responses for NPCs and other characters that make sense to what you've done and who you are.
Yeah, no, it must be almost impossible. Mm. You've just got to put so much in there that you hope that people won't uncover it too quickly.
Yeah, yeah.
So, right, I'm outside in Riverwood now. I'm the kind of player that I love to explore.
Mm.
And I've not learnt the controls yet. What am I doing? Oh, triangle is jump for some reason.
I think you're now stuck on the fence.
I'm stuck on
the
fence.
Oh, there we go.
This
no, it's fine.
Yeah, so I played this originally on the Xbox 360, so the controls are completely different to how
see, I've only ever played it on PC, which is one thing of, I don't know that this looks any better than the PC game did 5 years ago.
Yeah, it may
but
not.
That's the weird thing between consoles and PCs, isn't it? It's like consoles are now just as good as PCs, but for the longest time, the
PCs
reason you played a computer version of something was because the graphics were better, the performance was better, and you could customise your PC to match the kind of gameplay you wanted.
Mm. I mean, the draw distance necessary. Is certainly better. I can see down the river now.
That water effect does look very good.
It does. I mean, I was... Oh, who's talking to me?
I don't know.
Oh.
Someone's just chased you down the street.
Camilla
and is
Valerius
talking to you.
Is chasing me.
Did you leave mid-conversation?
Oh, I must have.
Oh, she's meant to be guiding you to somewhere, isn't she?
I have a letter from Feindal Lai.
Oh, who are they?
I'm going to tell her the truth.
You've somehow given... You have gained a letter.
Right. I'm going to tell her the truth.
What's in the letter?
Oh.
I remember who this is. I encountered a young man whose best friend fell in love with a woman he loved, so he wanted to write a letter from his friend, basically saying, I'm not interested anymore, so that he could then have the woman's heart, but I've told her the truth and said...
That sounds positively Shakespearean.
It does.
I mean, this is again a very interesting thing about building a plot, let alone a fantasy world, in a game setting rather than in a book or a film. You can't guide the observer through the story the same way.
The story sort of has to unfold naturally, has to reveal itself. So I guess, I mean, where am I going to go? I could go to
You could go get the Dragon Claw, or you could go do the main plot in Whiterun.
Let's have a look at the map.
I remember when I first played this game, there was actually a glitch in the PC version. Where if you walked into Whiterun, the entire game would crash.
Oh, really?
Which meant that for the longest time, I couldn't play the main plot line. There's plenty of other stuff you could do. You could go around the whole rest of the map and it would be fine.
Oh, no, but so much is based in Whiterun.
You just couldn't walk into Whiterun without the game crashing.
This map looks lovely.
It does.
I don't remember the original, but I don't remember it looking as good as this.
See,
it looks really
3D.
See,
on the PC version, I don't think you can rotate it.
Oh, really?
That's
you can't
really
rotate
helpful.
A huge amount, but you can just do that.
Yeah.
Amount that looks really nice, and there's the Throat of the World, which we'll
good
get
name
to
for
later.
A mountain, I feel.
Awesome, yeah. Right, I think Whiterun is a good place to go. It's where lots of stuff cracks off, and last time I played, I became a werewolf.
Oh, nice!
So
nice.
I could do that again.
I almost became a vampire one of my playthroughs.
I didn't mean to.
Oh,
really? I did become a vampire when the expansion, like the DLC, came out, and I tried to fight the gargoyle king of the vampires and ended up becoming a vampire, and it was rubbish.
I
oh
believe
my gosh.
You are actually climbing the mountain than going to Whiterun.
I haven't equipped any weapons.
Just punch the wolf to
punch
death.
The wolf. Oh, I did it. It worked.
See, that's something that's always slightly bothered me about this game, is that the way that the wolves are always enemies. And every game has this thing of everything hates you. It's like, why? I haven't done anything to him. It's plenty of things for him to eat. I've seen rabbits running around. He doesn't need to eat a human.
Yes, true. Yeah, I'm not sure why they're so ferocious.
But let's talk some about the fantasy world of Skyrim, or rather the fantasy world of Tamriel, which is the continent that we are on. Skyrim is the northernmost
The Nordic country? Part, I suppose.
Of Skyrim. It's clearly a non-Earth place, because it's nighttime now, we see stars, there's probably a moon somewhere, and I think at some point you can see up to 3 moons up there at once. Yeah, you're going up the mountain instead of just,
I don't know why I'm doing that.
There'll be things to kill up here.
I like that Skyrimming has become a verb to just jump up the side. So I'm going to be Skyrimming today. Yeah, I just jam myself up the side of the mountain.
It's like when you get a horse and the horse is just like, I don't care about gravity.
Yeah.
Straight up this sheer cliff. It's fine.
There we go. Doopy-doo.
And also, there's so many bandits and they don't wait to see what you're going to do.
No, they're like, hey, it's a person.
It's person. Kill them. Kill person.
It's like, wait. You haven't even asked me who I am.
I've never joined, like, the Dark Brotherhood or anything. Do they treat you differently if you're in sort of the assassin thief kind of vibe?
Yeah, I think so. I was halfway through that storyline when I stopped playing. I'd sort of learned the password and where the secret hideout was, but I'd never done any of their missions. But, yeah, they were much less kidnappy, murdery when you were friends with them. How do I run? Yeah. I haven't played this.
You
so
are
long.
Kind of running. You run faster if you're not holding a weapon.
That's true. There we go. There we Sprinty. Go.
But yeah, so the world of Tamriel is a giant continent that I think when I was swatting up on the wiki this morning is split into 9 different provinces, each of which is kind of primarily occupied by a race. So we are in Skyrim here, which is the Nord race, and the Nords are men. So this is one of the main kind of conceits. Oh, that wolf's actually running away!
Yeah,
that's amazing.
With an arrow in its head.
But the Nords are. So this is one of the main conceits of the Elder Scrolls world: is that there are 3 types of intelligent beings. There are mer, and there are men, and there are beasts.
Yes.
And so the men is pretty self-explanatory, although. In this, they are kind of treated almost as different species. Like, a Nord is very different from a Breton, or, like, from a Redguard.
Redguards are sort of looked down upon, really, aren't they? And they're sort of seen as the...
And your race, of course, in gameplay has important kind of repercussions for what your character can and can't do. And you're being blackmailed by an orc here.
Yeah. I'm not going to give them money. I haven't done anything wrong.
You're just going to beat up an orc.
Oh no, I'm going to regret this. Oh god.
Yeah. Oh, they've got a mage! Oh, you can throw fire too. Cool.
Run away. Run away.
And then you have the mer, which are what we would generally call in general high fantasy the elves. And they come in different flavours. So you have the high elves, who are the witch. It's basically like very witchy. They are the wizards and magic users. Yeah. You are playing as a wood elf, a Bosmer, aren't you?
I am indeed. My first playthrough, I was a Argonian lizard called Alizard.
Alizard.
Oh my god, this person needs to die.
They've got some armor. They've got magical armor on.
Oh no.
Oh no.
Oh gosh.
Are we going to die already? Yay.
Oh my gosh.
Potions. Do you have any healing spells?
Maybe. I was not ready for this. Potions.
But yes, and then...
That'll do.
But also coming under the heading of Myr are the... what we would call the dwarves, who've actually been extinct in this world for a very long time. This is one of the weird... another weird thing about the Elder Scrolls series is that there is a very, very long timeline involved.
Yes. Oh, thousands of years.
But at the same time, the games mostly take place... No! He's just skimming across the ground! The games mostly take place in the third and fourth era. I think Skyrim's the only one that takes place in the fourth era. But what I always thought was interesting is that the previous games literally are history. They're not
Oh no, I died.
Ali died.
This is very embarrassing.
Yeah.
This is the problem with trying to learn archery as your main. I should just get the sword. You need to snipe
it a lot more. Go hide in the background. Get a dagger or something.
Yeah, I think I'll be equipping a sword.
But yeah, so it's like there's a lot of history, and of course a lot of that history is the previous games.
Yes.
But you don't actually have to have played the previous games to play current ones.
No, in fact, Skyrim was my first game.
Yeah.
Oh, balls.
Oh, I'm all the way back in Riverwood.
Right.
Oh, she's coming out again,
she's
though.
Coming out, right. Let's break it to her.
And then finally you have the beasts, who are the Argonians and the Khajiit, who are cat people and lizard people.
Mm.
So as you say, you've previously played as...
Yes, as an Argonian.
And they're kind of, in the kind of mythos of the world, they're considered lesser beings. Like, there were gods that created the Mer and the Men, and then the beasts are sort of secondary in a strange way.
Yeah, the Khajiit have definitely looked down upon as more sort of thieves and up to no good travelling types.
Yeah,
and then the Argonians, I'm not quite sure what the problem is with the Argonians, but they're not very trusted, which is why I wanted to play as them the first time, because I thought, I'll change their opinion of my of my race.
It's very much how you play D&D as well.
It is, yes. I like to play the
underdog.
I don't know. Yeah, the underdog. That's a really good... Yeah, that is exactly what I like to do. Yeah. The people that are looked down upon but have a lot to prove.
Yeah. There's probably a quicker way to whiterun, you know.
There probably is. Let's sprint. Sprinty.
But yes, so this whole world is, populated by so many different races, and the history is full of conflict between these races and times of peace, and Skyrim itself is set at a time of a civil war which has been actually triggered by religious intolerance, which is actually
quite
a remarkably deep plot for
it is.
A game like this. And I mean, this is the strange thing of a question I would put to you, Ali, is Skyrim any different from any other game that doesn't have the fantasy trappings? Because
I feel like it is. I can't put my finger on why I love it quite so much. I mean, I loved Dragon Age Inquisition.
Mm.
I think that equals Skyrim in its sort of beauty and the way it just captured me completely. I just wanted to play it forever. Mm. But that was not so much an open world. You had open areas of a world. Ooh, but
giant, go kill the giant.
Oh, where? Ooh.
He's behind the hedge, that hut.
There we go. But what I just love about Skyrim is that you can just do what you want, where you want, when you want. And I know that that can then open up some loopholes as to why it could be bad, because some people might argue there's not quite enough freedom. I know that, you can't, you wanted to properly play a role, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, I mean, that's just the way I play these games. I really want to build a character. And I guess in order to keep it open, the game has to make sure that people don't necessarily know or react to me in a way that would be dictated by my character.
Mm.
But for someone like you, who wants to play every single side quest
on the
same playthrough...
Yeah. I'm very much a collector. I like to pick every lock, open every chest, talk to every character. And for the sake of not boring everyone on this video, I am going to sort of try and keep it a bit more concise. But this is the first game I ever played where you could interact with everyone.
Mm.
You could open any door, pretty much. It just blew my mind, and I think I put over 200 hours into my first playthrough of Skyrim, and I still don't think I saw every area of the map.
Did you ever actually finish the Dragonborn plotline? I think we discussed this before.
No, I got to the monks, and there was a big dragon that came down, and I fought him, and I played a bit further than that, but I never ever chose between the Stormcloaks and the Empire. Never made that choice because I thought, I'll play a bit more. I'll just make sure I understand my choice. And I thought, just a bit more. Because I thought, there's so many implications of this choice. It's so important that I never ended up making the choice.
I went to almost the other extreme. I made no choice by brokering the peace between them.
Oh,
and then
really?
You can broker peace between them, at least a ceasefire. And
see,
then
I had no idea. I didn't know
And it's
that.
A really long and slightly boring sequence of dialogue trees, basically, which is a staple of role-playing games.
Yeah.
But I found the dialogue trees in Skyrim were not particularly inspired. I think what bothered me the most about the role-playing in Skyrim was that I had watched someone play Fallout 3 in very similar time. And that seemed to have a lot more to offer in terms of role-playing. Like, your actions would then... Oh, wow, you can actually see the city. That's cool. Sorry.
It's brilliant.
But, your actions would actually make people react to you in a different way. What you were wearing would change how they reacted to you. The kinds of things you said to them would change and could be affected by that. And it's like... It's the same company, it's Bethesda, at pretty much the same time. Like, Fallout 3 and Skyrim are about...
Yeah, they're contemporaries, really. Yeah.
And yet you don't have those options in Skyrim?
No, isn't quite so much of that, is there? And that's something I really liked about Mass Effect.
See, I've never played Mass Effect, and I feel that I really should.
Yes.
I've heard the first game is a bit of a slog.
I loved all of them. But I loved the dialogue trees that you could open up with that, and that I would always... prioritise upgrading my persuasion and my sassiness so that I had all the good responses to everyone.
Were you Paragon or Renegade?
I was somewhere in between. I like to be badass at times, but ultimately have a good heart. So I would... ultimately, I was a Paragon, really. I feel like I'm back home.
There are some beautiful locations in this game, and that's something I definitely think you wouldn't get outside of the fantasy setting. And just things like, a couple of times I've listened to this guy in the corner. Oh, he's not here at the moment because it's nighttime.
Oh, the guy that shouts.
Yeah, shouting at the statue. Because that's basically what tells you the plot of this whole thing. The idea that the Nords want to worship a god called Talus, who they believe is... the sort of ascended form of a former emperor. And they want to worship him because they're like, he's a man who became a god, therefore he's more worthy of worship than the eight gods the elves think are.
Makes sense.
Yeah. And the conflict has arisen because the elven kind of dominion, the Eldmeri dominion, want to stop the worship of Talus because they actually believe that it's dangerous, that... You know, because they truly believe in the eight divines, because it's a fantasy world. Religion is a real thing. Like, your gods are real. You can actually go talk to them, you know. And so they believe that worshipping Talos as the ninth of the divines is actually dangerous and will bring down the wrath of the eight divines. And that's the core conflict that started this whole thing. And now there is a faction in Skyrim that wants Skyrim to be independent so they can have their own religious freedom and be... free of the Empire and the Dominion. And I thought that's actually a very deep plot for this. But
it is.
And there's...
But it's all quite subtly put across. It's not sort of the main narrative necessarily, if you don't want it to be. I'm looking for... What's his name? Koldak?
I don't know. She always struck me as irritating.
Yeah, she's a bit cold.
Yeah.
So I'm back in my good old haunt with the companions.
Yeah, and it's a very good hall.
I love it here.
I'm not sure that fireplace is up to health and safety standards.
No.
But, you know.
Does it hurt me? No.
No, it doesn't.
Amazing.
Just stand in the fire. You are Dragonborn, even if you don't know.
That's
it.
That's true.
Spoilers, Dragonborn.
If you don't know that now, then
there's one reason I haven't put any kind of spoiler warning on this. This is a 5-year-old game.
Get with the times.
Yeah.
Last time I spent a lot of time with the companions. They sent me on many missions to kill beasties, and I even, I can't remember if it was a companion. She's a bit haggard. I once had to find a goat for someone.
Oh, good, good.
In fact, I think I was drinking in a bar in the Dwarven City, and I woke up in the middle of nowhere, and the name of the quest was Dude, Where's My Goat?
Oh, wow.
And I had to go and help this poor man. I got into a drinking contest to go and find his goat that we'd somehow lost the night before.
Oh, that's fantastic.
In order to help me on my quest, on the way out of the city, I bought a dog. I'd never bought a dog before, and it was 500 coins, and I thought, my you know, trusty pal, my little dog friend.
How long before it died?
The goat ended up being kidnapped by a massive giant.
Yeah.
And the first thing the giant did was he walked over to me, smashed my dog high into the sky with his club.
Oh dear.
And I got the goat, but I had to say goodbye to my poor dog.
Aww. Well, I think I managed to hit upon a really interesting little plot line, because when I was just running around, there was a dog that talked to me. There is a talking dog.
There is,
game.
And you have to follow him, don't you?
You have to follow the talking dog, and it leads you to one of the big subplots and one of the big kind of mythological things behind Skyrim is the idea of the Daedra, who were equal to the divines, but they chose not to create the world. Like, they chose not to put their power into creating the world, so they became, like, the evil princes. But some of them are less evil than others. And this dog has somehow connected to one of them. And so you end up following this dog into this dungeon and meeting one of the Daedric princes. And every Daedric prince you could meet, I think you can meet like 7 or 8 of them in this game, and they'll offer you like a shiny thing. You'll get like a super weapon from them. And they'll be like, go forth in my name and do my deeds. And you can say no and they'll still give you the shiny thing. So I ended up with like a magic sword that killed the undead because it had like sunlight powers. I can't remember. I think I had a shield at one point as well, so just like tons of magical weaponry, which is great fun.
Lots of swag.
But yeah, and I think those are certain things that you probably wouldn't get if this was a sci-fi game.
No.
Because you wouldn't get that aspect of... You wouldn't get that aspect of the supernatural is real. Like, the gods are actual people that you can go talk to.
And there's evidence of them. Yeah. Everywhere.
And... Otherwise, because it's like, you know, the different races could just be, you know, different alien races, and the world could easily just be, like, a planet somewhere.
It could be futuristic. Yeah. I think I'm just going to do my age-old tradition and just walk in a direction
okay,
and see what
fine.
Happens.
So you're not going to trigger the dragon?
No, I think for now, I'm, because I haven't followed all the loose ends that I'm starting to unravel, which is... I have to speak to everyone and do everything. So I think I'm just going to pick a direction and see what I find.
And that is definitely a strength of the gameplay.
Yeah.
In Skyrim.
I mean, one of the ways I used to get around... Oh, God, right, let's not jump down there.
Oh, jump off the cliff. Jump off the cliff.
One of the ways I used to get around in Skyrim was not to fast travel and just walk everywhere. And I know it's not
quite... Oh, the Khajiit are here.
Yeah, Khajiit. Oh. I know it's not quite real time, but I would just really enjoy... just walking and experiencing it.
I think one wiki I read said something like this is about 17. There's about 17 square miles of gameplay land in Skyrim.
That's amazing.
It's but it's odd how it's still very small, isn't it? Even in this day and age, I kind of wonder, and we'll probably get onto this at some point. I wonder if like Elder Scrolls 6 is going to be the whole of Tamriel. You know,
that would
like,
be amazing.
Surely we're getting to the point where you can easily render that kind of space. And even, like, there's a rebirth of, sort of random generation of land and things you could fill in the gaps with.
Mm.
I think it's a lot more elaborate now, you know, procedural generation than it used to be.
Yeah.
And you can probably get a lot more in there. Like, imagine if they built Elder Scrolls 6... with the generation features from No Man's Sky.
That would be incredible. Yeah. I mean, yeah, No Man's Sky had many, many flaws.
It did.
But,
it did.
The idea was sound, and I would love to see a fantasy-style setting for that.
Yeah.
I'm just going to pick a sort of place on the map and put a marker there and walk
Go
to
one
it.
Of the cities, because
Well, Markarth is the dwarven city, if I'm remembering rightly, I think.
I don't think you can actually find any dwarves, though.
Dwarves are all
They're all
dead.
Extinct.
They're all gone. Solitude up in the top left.
Oh yeah, that's a kind of a fun
that's
one.
That's the Imperial owned.
And then there's Winterhold, which is the mages' place.
Yeah,
isn't
we've
it?
Got Dawnstar up there. Yeah, Windhorn.
I love these names. It was good names. And
they're really good names.
And Windhelm.
I always struggled a bit with Windhelm. Everyone was very mean to me as an Argonian. They were always, I think, a few Argonian
Windhelm
slaves
is racist, apparently.
Yes, they are. And then down here, we've got the thieves' city of Riften.
I didn't survive long in Riften.
No?
I went and tried, and I was just terrible at stealth, basically.
I love stealth.
I've had playthroughs since where I really emphasised, like, upping my stealth skill, like, literally, like, crouching and walking everywhere so that my stealth would upgrade as I was walking. But with that playthrough, I played the Archmage.
Winterhold.
Winterhold playthrough, and didn't really take it any further because I was like, oh, well, now I'm Archmage. I don't know quite what to do next. You can find vampires in Morthal, can't you?
Can you?
I think so.
Morthal?
I think that's where I was turned into a vampire, because there's the swamp, and you can go out into the swamp.
I don't remember Morthal as well as the others.
I don't think it's a particularly big or exciting city.
Oh. I was going to say I could walk there. Let's walk. Let's walk
to Morthal.
It's the journey, not the destination.
So, you have also, Ali, played Elder Scrolls Online, which came out a couple of years ago.
Yes, I did.
And you only played it earlier this year.
Yes, but, well, I played it...
you were busy, you know, bettering yourself to get an MA.
I pre-ordered it. I did my MA from September 2014 to September 2015, and we'd pre-ordered it the beginning of 2014.
Because it was delayed by quite a bit, wasn't
it? Yeah, it was due to come out later that year, around September, I can't quite remember, but anyway, it was delayed and delayed and delayed. Eventually it came out June 2015,
right?
So a year and a half after we pre-ordered it, and of course I was in the middle of my MA and I was sort of approaching the big project, and I thought, I can't start playing this because it's going to suck the life, you know, away from me.
All the time will vanish.
Yeah, and so I put it aside and I allowed myself to create my character, and that was it. And then I thought, right, that is all, and I will play it in a few months' time. And I did, in sort of October time, I decided to start playing it, and a few hours in, I absolutely hated it.
Yes, well, it's interesting because we're looking up some of the backstory of Elder Scrolls Online, and it's set sort of earlier than any other of the games, I believe. So in this strange period of history, and one of the things that struck me is that nothing's changed.
No, that's the weird thing.
That's always one of the faults, I feel, of a fantasy setting, is that often hundreds of years go by and the technology is exactly the same. And even the magic is exactly the same. Like, you'd maybe expect them to make as many advances in magic as we would make in science at the same time.
And architecture as well, you think maybe is it more primitive?
There was nothing to indicate that the Elder Scrolls Online wasn't just taking place at the same time as Skyrim.
No. And I was so excited just to experience a new world within the Scrolls. You know, series.
Because it was set in a completely different part of the world as well. Yeah. I can't remember where exactly. And it was big. You could go and see beaches, and there were, like, pirate ships and things.
It was so big, It was incredible. You know, the idea behind it was sound enough, perhaps. Oh, no.
Oh, bandits.
Baddies. Where are they?
Shootify the bandits. You're not being sneaky enough.
Oh, I should be sneaky, shouldn't I? Where are they? How are they shooting me? And I'm not shooting them.
Yeah, I can see his head.
There you are.
So yes, Ali is now failing to aim at bandits.
I feel like I'm aiming at them. How am I not hitting him?
You need to upgrade your archery a bit more.
This is the problem with archery. Like, it's something I didn't do so much of in the previous playthrough. I was very much magic and, just
swords.
Yeah, whatever I had to hand.
I've done a straight sword playthrough, and I've done, like, a straight magic playthrough. And I'm now trying for a mixed playthrough. On my current PC.
It's a good idea, yeah.
I'm just trying to go
but
for
I
magic
really,
and swords.
I really wanted to do more archery in my previous one, so I thought, I'll start with archery in this one. But it's such a hard one to start with, because you're very, very weak.
Yeah. You have to be able to sneak up on them. You have to kind of be able to find a vantage point and snipe down at them and then level up really quickly, hopefully.
There we go.
Bandit.
No!
Oh, it's a zappy bandit.
No, I need a good headshot. Go away.
Yay!
Is that another thing I saw then?
I think you literally just, like, poked her in the eye with an arrow.
Oh, it's a mud crab. God, can this day get any worse? Oh, a lockpick. I loves me a lockpick.
Do you need some non-imperial armour? Like, that's the thing I'm never quite clear. Do people care what you're wearing in Skyrim?
No, I don't think so. Well, when I was a... is that a wolf? When I was a werewolf, people could smell me.
Oh, how weird.
So people would comment that I smelt like a wet dog, which was always nice. I just realised there's another advantage of crouching everywhere is that you can tell when someone is watching
yes,
you. So
yeah.
I might be crouching a little bit from now on. Just
that might
helps.
Take a while.
It might take a while.
You might not be able to Skyrim up the mountain that way, but
no.
we'll give it a go.
It helps for while you're out in the open, and especially because we're watching without the sound on.
Yes. Yeah.
It helps me know someone's shouting at me. What were we saying?
We were talking about Elder Scrolls Online and why you didn't like it.
Yes. So, yeah, the whole point I love Skyrim is you can walk into the countryside and you can explore and you can be... at one with nature and experience things
Speaking
that no
of,
one
this nature
might have
is
seen.
Beautiful, by the way.
It is stunning.
And there is a stag that just ran out.
It's gorgeous. I might kill it. No, I won't kill it. You could sort of... You felt like you had a perspective that no one else had, that you were one amongst millions of people in the world, but no one else was with you. You were sort of experiencing it for yourself. And then you play... Elder Scrolls Online and you're queuing to talk to someone who is in a cave that you've just fought hard to go and see and there's 10 other people or 20 people all crowded round talking to the same person and you think I'm not special in fact it's more special to not be doing this
I think that's always going to be the fault of kind of the Memorpaga layout you know, it's the problem with World of Warcraft. Even though you're playing on a server that has maybe a couple of hundred people on it, they're all trying to be the chosen one as well. And maybe in World of Warcraft it's not so obvious because it's entirely based around that idea. But in Skyrim, it's always been there's the chosen one. That's always you know, someone starts as a prisoner. You always start as a prisoner.
Yeah,
in Elder Scrolls games, you start as a prisoner and then you rise up to become, you know, the one that. Decides the destiny of everyone else in the world. And you can't really do that in a massive... It's not a story you can tell in a massively multiplayer situation. Unless people are willing to play the NPCs.
Yeah. Oh,
it's a troll!
No,
run from the troll!
Why did I think this was a good idea?
Oh, but he's very far behind. Do you have any fire spells, though? Fire spells are good for them.
I don't know if I've got any spells for now.
Go around him. Go up the mountain.
Yeah.
Oh, look, moon. Giant moon.
Wow.
See, that's, you know, you're
that's
definitely
awesome.
Not in Kansas, are
not
you?
In any earthly place. Yeah, so Elder Scrolls Online did not survive for very long. It's now in CEX.
Good, good.
We still have the special edition Gomph that came with it, because I like all of that. But the game itself was no good. And I love the world. I love going to a city and... talking to the people when everyone in the city is another person playing online and you can't talk to them and they're jumping around or they're on a horse going up some steps and you think you look stupid. it kind of ruins the moment.
It's a matter of construction, I guess, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like this world has been crafted to tell certain stories in it. It has its flaws, it's not perfect, but they went with a theme. And I'm always impressed at the amount of backstory and thought there is in the Elder Scrolls world. And just how actually, like, internally consistent it is. Like, they didn't need to put so much effort into it. Like, on the wiki page, there's, like, 6 different eras worth of history that you can read up on. And it's all just mentioned somewhere. Like, there's a book somewhere you can read that tells you this stuff. But it's not actually necessary for any of the plots that I can... tell. And I think that's very impressive that there is just this massive, massive plot that you could get involved with if you wanted, but you don't have to.
Here we go. I'm dual wielding magic and daggers.
Magic and daggers.
So good combo.
Always.
Distance and close proximity.
Yeah. I love the range of spells that are available in this and the things they can do, and it's actually quite tactical. Like, when I did my magic playthrough of Skyrim, my favourite one was, I think it was Rage, the spell,
mm-hmm.
and it was an illusion spell. And basically, I got my stealth so high that I could sneak into a dungeon, cast Rage on someone in one of the bandits or whoever was in the dungeon.
Oh, yeah.
They would then go nuts and kill everyone else in the dungeon. And so long as they didn't see you, you were fine.
That's the thing. You don't have to be the most powerful person if someone else is.
That was one of my favourite tactics. And I mean, obviously, that's the kind of thing. It's purely gameplay, but it works really well in a fantasy setting. You know, that kind of idea of I am just an expert at taking over other people's minds. And I can just do that. And it has exactly the same kind of play mechanic as throwing flames at them or lightning.
Now, I actively avoided necromancy spells, though, because I thought, I'm a good person, I'm not going to...
I've never played the necromancy stuff. How many NPCs can you get following you around?
Yes, it'd be interesting to find out.
Just have an army of bunnies.
Right, now, Redoran's Retreat, I remember this cave. Yeah. I feel such a nerd, you know, I can remember a specific cave. I'm probably going to regret going in here, because I'm pretty sure it's full of bandits.
Bandits are good for levelling up.
Yeah, someone's definitely going to level up. It could be them.
It's like the core plotline of Skyrim, which you are not playing.
No.
There we go. Is that the sort of ancient god of destruction, Alduin, who happens to be a dragon, has somehow been reborn in this kind of, you know, thousands of years after he was last defeated, I guess.
And you have
learned that you can absorb dragon souls and use the dragon language to cast sort of shouts.
Yes.
And this makes you the one chosen one, the dragonborn.
Mm.
And then the plot is basically you going around taking down various dragons, trying to solve some of Skyrim's problems, and eventually... And this will be spoilers if you have not completed Skyrim, I guess.
Oh my gosh!
Oh no!
That is not
you poor man.
Ladylike.
Stab him a few times. Like, just move him out of the way. I'm sorry. In case we have not got the video up, Ali's just managed to kill someone in a very compromising position.
Yes, he sort of.
Why did he put so much starch in his armor? That's what I want to know. Like, that wouldn't have been a problem if his armour hadn't been stiff as a board. Like, it would have been fine. But now we know exactly what a Nord wears up their kilt. So,
yep, not much is the answer.
Including no genitals, which is impressive. Like,
just a big dark hole.
Yeah.
Right, is there anything valuable in here? But I know there's bits further on.
Eventually, you make it to the Nord's afterlife, Sylvengard,
mm-hmm.
and take down the dragon there with the help of the ancient kind of heroes of Skyrim, which I thought was a really nice plot. The trouble is, if you do just that, I completed that plot at level 14.
Oh, really?
And then I was like, what next? I think that was another of my problems with Skyrim. Each individual story that you can do is actually quite short, because the idea is you're meant to run 20 of them at once.
Yes.
And again, it's just another limit on the role-playing, which I do love very much.
I mean, I can understand it, because if you don't want to plunge hundreds of hours into it, but you still want to experience mm-hmm. the story, then you don't. It's not exclusive, completely anyway. But I'm someone that absolutely loves, you know. I wasn't a hugely high level, because, like I said, I did just like to walk everywhere. So a lot of that time was just spent aimlessly walking around. But I think I was like level 46.
Oh, okay.
By the time I probably stopped playing. Which of these is better? I've got a longbow and a hunting bow. Ooh, hunting bow just takes
better.
Yeah.
You can sell the longbow and turn it into more hunting bows. Anyway, he looks a lot more dignified now, so that's good. Now time to take all his clothes.
He looks at peace now. Yeah. Tried to proposition me. It did not work.
No. But yeah, so, again, plotting in a game situation. I hope we will look at some other sort of fantasy games or something to compare
definitely.
It, but I definitely feel it's all, oh, he's singing, good.
Why do I feel like there's a trap somewhere?
Oh, probably.
I know sometimes there are tripwires
you
need to watch out for, but I don't think there is, right?
I mean, I suppose it is probably reasonably
deep
gameplay.
No! No!
You weren't sneaky enough!
No!
Fill her through a vial of arrows.
Oh no.
Burn him.
Oh, I've de-quipped my magic. You're not gonna quick, like a quick select thing.
No, I can't remember how to do that. Oh god. Right, I think I'm gonna have fire in one hand and health in the other.
Oh, good plan. This is a good plan. Hit them both at once.
Ah.
Remember that you have to use the health spells.
What's happening? Oh no!
Brutally murdering you.
Oh no, am I going to go back to Riverwood?
No, you should save the last time you left a door. When was the last time you left a door?
Oh, when I came into the place.
You might be alright then. Yeah, oh, that's all there right. We go.
All right, I'm going to do it better this time.
Yeah, try that, but better.
Without provocative deaths as well by certain bandit members. Right, so I'm going to equip the bow and arrow to take him down.
Just sneak.
Oh yes, I don't have the bow that he gave me.
Lots of sneaking. Yes. Sneak. So yes, what was the plot line supposed to be for Elder Scrolls Online?
Do you know what? I honestly couldn't tell you very much. You begin in like the underworld. Oh, I'm so sorry, doggy. You just killed your owner and now I'm killing you slowly.
He could not kill you and it would be fine.
Yeah. Oh, I feel bad. Yeah, I'd heard so much bad press about Elder Scrolls Online. Yeah. And so I think I went into it already being sceptical. And so I didn't really put a lot of time into learning the mythology of it because I thought, well, if I'm only going to be playing this for a short while,
yeah,
do I really want to put all this time and effort into learning it? Which is probably a bad attitude to have.
Maybe.
So yeah, I honestly couldn't tell you very much. I know there's a big war going on in the centre, which is sort of ongoing always, I think. It was a strange one. And
just set fire to him, lots. Lots of fire. Fire cures everything.
But I'm generally quite bad at getting the larger picture in these sorts of games. Oh no! My magic is too low.
Why would you say you pick Skyrim over, say, like Fallout? Because you've played Fallout 2, haven't you?
Nick has played Fallout 3 and I've watched a lot of that. The world of Fallout seemed very sort of sad and brown.
Yeah.
And also, if you want a bit of escapism from your day, you know, if you come home and you've had a tough day at work, I'd much rather go, I'm gonna enter into a magical world than go, oh, I'm going to enter into a post-nuclear apocalypse, that, you know, dystopian future that where everyone is miserable and dying. So yes, this sort of grabs my imagination a little bit. No, you're not going to kill me. Oh gosh, maybe you are. Okay.
Have any potions?
I'm gonna heal. Yes.
find some potions. This is a wonderful thing. Like, again, in a non fantasy game as well. You know, they have to come up with weird medical reasons for you to be able to heal instantly. It's just magic.
Oh my god.
Magic potion.
I am doing so badly at this game.
It's quite impressive. You can get him, Kill
come
him,
on.
Kill him, kill
stop.
Him.
Lemon shield.
You're
come
gonna
on.
Die.
Oh
you're
no.
gonna die.
Oh no, there we go.
Yay! Stab him.
Yay.
Stab him lots. Stab him up the arse.
I did not deserve to win that fight.
He's got so many shiny things.
He has.
Take his sword. Yep. And his gold.
Ooh, armor.
Nice armor as well.
Let's take this.
This is the thing, it's like, again, fantasy world, so it's... Oh, yeah, yeah.
He's naked now.
Like I said, this is the traditional way of honouring the dead in Skyrim. You strip them naked and you leave them in a hole. This is a thing of every kind of game like this. Like, there is just resources being thrown at you left, right, and centre.
Yeah.
So how do you decide what you actually bother carrying around?
Definitely.
With
when I first started Skyrim, like the first ever playthrough of Skyrim, I had no idea what I would need and wouldn't need, and the fact you could interact with, like, this cup.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, I'll take that cup. Oh, and I'll take that cup. And then...
But you can't pick up any of those bedrolls, which might actually be thematically useful.
Like, you can sleep in them, but you can't pick them up. But, very quickly my pockets were full because I just had pockets and pockets full of plates and cups. because I might need them one day.
This is a history book that you've just picked up. From Last Seed 2920 of the First Era. So this is like,
This is telling history that's like a couple of thousand years old.
It's now, quite amazing. Isn't it? Yeah.
And you could sit and read all of this and learn the whole plot. I learned so much backstory. Does anybody? I mean, I read a fair bit of it in my first playthrough.
Before I realised how how many books there were.
Yeah, yeah.
I did try and read them, but I very quickly learned that there were a lot.
Once I had Breeze Home, I quite liked collecting them to actually like put on my bookshelf.
Yeah, on your bookshelf. Yeah. You cook some food.
Oh yeah, I never bothered doing that really. I mean, because you get just as much health from eating a cabbage soup as you do from eating a cabbage.
Oh, really?
Really? I mean, does it help? I don't know. Maybe it does.
So a cabbage soup gives you 10 points of health.
Or maybe a cabbage will only give you one or something.
Yeah, I would imagine it must give you some sort of advantage.
Yeah.
Cabbage will give you one.
Okay, fair enough. So you can make...
When I was an Argonian, my health regenerated so quickly on its own that I never really cooked stuff.
That was something I kind of wanted from Skyrim. I wanted like a hardcore mode. I wanted a mode that would mean you didn't ever regenerate health unless you used a potion, or if you didn't eat, you would start losing health, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Which there isn't an option. Ooh, a trap. Poke it.
I see you, trap. You can't get me. Gold. Treasure
map. Oh, and a treasure map.
Iron boots and
Let's
armor.
Go.
Amazing.
So, yeah.
Let's have a look at the treasure map.
But, yeah, so you've actually collected quite a few books.
Cool.
Oh, it's
That's a
windmill.
Very cryptic...
Is that the windmill outside the brewery? Like, because that's
be.
A picture of... That's a picture of Whiterun.
Yeah,
so it's the windmill outside Whiterun. And Ooh. Then go up the mountain a bit.
Cool.
Nice.
Right.
We might perhaps have time to do that.
Indeed. I'm just going to save... If I can figure out how to save. There we go.
If you are watching the video, if that has worked, you may just have seen a break. Hopefully we're back in the room now.
Yep. I'm hoping it's worked. I've never done this before. Right, so, I mean, I could go back to Whiterun and try and find that treasure. That could be a good mini quest.
Let's do that. That seems like a plan.
Bye-bye, dead bandits. Yeah. Did I pick that lock?
No!
Oh.
You didn't. How dare you?
Oh, I've got to unpick all the locks. I it was the only skill in the first playthrough where I went legendary.
Ooh.
Got to level 100 lock picking.
I really wanted to figure out how to make dragon scale armor.
Mm-hmm.
So in my playthrough, I was just collecting loads and I just had a chest in my house full of dragon scales. But the trouble is, you have to level up completely on the smithy.
Yeah.
And it's not like you can just find a smithy. And why, I was like, why can't I just ask someone to make me this? Why can't I just pay them to make this for me?
You have to make it yourself.
Yeah, you have to make it yourself. But in order to do that, you have to learn how to make like elven armor and dwarven armor
and glass armor.
Yeah, and glass armor. It's just like you have to work your way up. And it's like I want to figure out how to make scales into armor.
Apparently, there's not very much industry. Everyone has to do it themselves. It's like, can't we just pay people?
You could fast travel just
to
there.
I could. Let's fast travel to Whiterun.
Rah!
Oh, there's the monk.
Yeah.
I remember him
shouting
at me.
The greybeards, aren't they?
Yeah.
I never realised that you could rotate the models on the loading screens.
Oh, I love it. And
there's
you use both sticks, both joysticks, they go twice as fast.
Ooh. So whilst we are... Whilst we're doing this quest, it's a beautiful day in Whiterun.
So I'm going to leave Whiterun and try and find that treasure. Location.
You can just kind of throw yourself off the wall here without hurting yourself, which I always found was a quicker way to get down. I feel like he needs to think better about how his tail pokes out the back of his...
Yes, there's an Argonian bartender on this loading screen and it's just cut a hole in the back of his trousers.
Yeah,
his
surely
tail.
There's some tailoring you could do there, like if you just run off that corner.
Oh yeah.
You could just drop down, it cuts off that hole.
Let's do it. What? Oh yeah, that's good. I never know that.
That's just me throwing myself off things. So you need to get to that windmill.
Windmill.
Which is over there. So we should probably at least talk some more about the actual fantasy of Skyrim. Obviously, there is magic. There are elves.
Mm-hmm.
There were dwarves. There are kind of beast races that are clearly sentient.
Yeah.
It's very classic Western fantasy, I find.
Mm-hmm.
It's all got all good tropes. But then you do get some sort of different things, like the idea of all the gods, the good and evil gods, the Daedra and the Divines.
Yeah.
Which I think gives it an interesting flavour. It's a bit different. I think the RPG elements of Arena, the first game, were actually based on D&D at the time, which I guess in 1994 would have probably been D&D 2.
Mm-hmm.
And which I think the later D&D's got a lot more... As D&D has gone on, there's been a lot more scope for variation in things. Ah, you're trying to figure out exactly where that drawing is on.
I'm pretty sure it's pointing to...
I think, yeah, it's pointing to that ledge up there, isn't
ledges.
It? Okay, time to scrim up a mountain.
Yeah. I'm wondering if I can set a marker?
Plonk a marker up there somewhere. I don't think it's that far up. I think it's just like it's on that cliff face, yeah.
That sort of place?
Ish, I think.
That will help me.
Let's just go straight up this
let's
mountain.
Let's go up the mountain.
But I think that's an interesting flavour, as I said.
Mm.
I don't know, what is your favourite thing about sort of the world of Skyrim in terms of plot and setting?
That's a tricky one, because I sort of just all of the little things add up to one awesome mm-hmm. thing. I think I like that there are different sort of allegiances that you can have, and not just the Imperial or the Stormcloak allegiance. I like that you've got things like the Dark Brotherhood and the Companions, and even the vampires as well.
Yeah,
that's
another
allegiance, really. There's so many ways you can play it, even though you're not playing you, because you're still sort of bound by the choices that are available to you. You can still very much have one experience that you could talk to someone else who's played Skyrim, and they have a completely different experience to you because they've chosen a different allegiance.
Mm.
And even the different races as well. When I chose Argonian, it was to prove that my race was good. If you pick Nord, you would have a much easier time of it, I imagine, because everyone is...
You are in the Nord homeland.
Exactly.
I've quite often played Nord, just because I've... Again, it's the role-playing thing. I've played Nord and I've played High Elf. And I think I'm currently playing a Breton.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're very good at magic, and I really wanted to do a kind of joint magic weapons playthrough. There's a lot of, like, Breton traders around that you suddenly notice. And they talk to you... They don't give you any good deals or anything, I don't think, but not that I've found any that will yet. But they talk to you as if you're family, rather than there's sort of different ways of them speaking to you, which I thought was cool.
It's an amazing attention to detail that you so easily could have, each race could have its different pros and cons, but you could have ultimately just been treated the same. But they've really made it into a political atmosphere as well.
Yeah, yeah. It was interesting playing as a High Elf. I didn't play the Dragonborn plotline when I was playing a High Elf. I went purely for the magic. I found it vaguely interesting that the people at the college didn't speak too badly of you, but you would occasionally run against people who said bad things about, like, the Old Mary Dominion, because the High Elves are the sort of main power in the Dominion. So little hints like that are kind of cool.
Yeah, it all builds to a bigger picture. And I remember when I first heard of Skyrim, because I've been gaming for many years, but I've never been a... religious gamer. Like, I've never
been
someone.
I'm very picky about what I play.
Yeah.
As well.
but I was speaking to someone at a party, and they said, "Oh, my girlfriend's made me trade in Skyrim because I've spent the last 6 months on it." And I was like, "What? What is this Skyrim that you're speaking of?" And he told me just a tiny bit about it, and I thought, "I have to get this."
Yeah.
Like, I've never played this before.
It's very pretty snow, by the way.
It's they've added in lots of little sparkles.
Ooh.
It's really good.
Stop admiring the scenery.
So, and he told me, like, it's this whole world, and I just thought, that sounds incredible. and I have always enjoyed very tight games where you can play it in 8 hours and it's really satisfying.
I'm the same. I mean, frankly, a lot of the reason I don't game as much these days as I used to is I just don't have the time.
No, exactly.
And I can't play a 60-hour RPG.
No. But then again, a game that is this free roaming, you almost can just dip in for half an hour.
Yeah.
You don't have to be keeping track of, well, what was I doing again? Because you can just walk and see what happens.
You're probably going to get attacked by skeletons if you keep going this way.
Or snow trolls or something.
I think it's skeletons at this one.
I'm trying to find...
I think you need to go through that pass, don't you? You need to go the other side of that mountain.
It's so steep.
Yeah, Ali has run up most of the side of a mountain here and is kind of being bamboozled at the last point.
So annoying.
Irritating.
I can't Skyrim my way up this one either. Yeah.
Can you kind of go sideways? Like sometimes
Maybe, you can trick it by trying to go zigzag your way up.
Oh yeah, I always preferred playing third person because like you put a lot of effort into what your character looks
like.
Yeah,
I did a lot in third person in my other playthrough.
Oh yeah, we're doing quite well. Can we get up there without getting stuck?
Oh, there's a ledge there. Can I squeeze it?
No.
I'm mashing the jump button and nothing's happening.
No, probably not. Maybe. Ooh. Yay! Okay, keep going.
This is potentially my favourite thing about Skyrim, is just its unrealistic rock climbing capabilities. Right, I'm not having any luck this
time. Try going over that edge. Yeah. Like, see if you can go that way.
Jump!
Oh, just go straight round it. Like, let's go right round the peak.
If I fall, I'm so dead.
Yep.
Oh, that was a good hop.
Oh, there we go. We're going.
Making progress. I'm floating.
It's like you're flying. I think I did in one playthrough. I saved and threw myself off the throat of the world just because I wanted to see what happened.
That's pretty badass.
You can make it quite a long way down.
Can you?
Actually, just straight down the side.
Go. This is very slow progress up the side of
this
mountain.
Must. If you are watching the video, this must be thrilling viewing here. Well, at least we can kind of see Whiterun and the windmill down there, so we must be close.
That's true.
Whiterun?
That's
Riverwood, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes, that's Riverwood.
You need to go right round this mountain to the other side.
So I'm currently facing the... Okay, yeah.
We're all right. Just keep going. We're fine.
Jump. Come on. Get up on there. That's a good ledge.
Yay,
there we go.
Whew. We're getting there. Now you've just got to drop down on whatever.
Right, so that's Whiterun down there.
Yes, yeah.
Oh my god.
So hopefully we will find this treasure very soon.
This treasure better be worth it.
Yeah.
I bet it's just a book.
Yeah.
A stinking old book.
But yeah, so I think it's interesting that you and your character here is wearing the Imperial armour.
Yes. That is not to
hadn't
say.
Noticed.
It's the first thing
Are you
I
going
found.
To be choosing the Imperial side in this plot?
I have a feeling I'm going to go Stormcloak.
They might be annoyed if you turn up at Windhelm wearing that.
Yeah. I feel like
the rock is
Imperial is the more sort of... You can guess what's going to happen. It's the more predictable way to go. You know, if you want the Empire to take over, then the Empire will take over.
Yeah.
If you go Stormcloak, I get the feeling it's potentially... bit more exciting, but I don't know for sure. Like I say, I never actually chose an allegiance in my previous playthrough.
Yeah, where are you going?
I don't know.
You've got to be somewhere close because you can see the windmill.
Where's right?
Yeah, because there's the windmill down there, all the way down there.
I've probably gone much too far up the mountain.
Maybe.
It was probably much easier to get. I bet there was a
path. Where was that map again? Look at that map. How far up did it say you needed to go? But, I think it's interesting to talk about the different ways of telling a story.
Yes.
In different mediums. And I think the fantasy video game doesn't always work.
No.
And it quite often has flaws. But, ooh, chest!
Could this be the treasure?
But I think Skyrim was very cool.
Definitely.
I enjoyed it very much.
Yes.
Gems!
Yay!
Moonstone.
A pretty
you
treasure.
You found the treasure. Now,
I'm assuming this is the treasure.
I hope so. Now, perhaps you should just find a damn good view.
And jump off it.
And jump off it. And then we can probably end there.
That would be a hell of an ending. Okay, that sounds good. I'm going to do a proper save, not a quick save, just in case. Here we go. I know it's working now.
Yeah.
Right, so let's save over that one.
Saving, yes. Saving. So, I think that is the end of this episode of First Chair Fantasy. Ali's just going to find a damn good suicide spot here. And,
right, let's take in this beautiful view.
Oh, it is very pretty.
The draw distance is so much, yeah. But I swear you couldn't do this with the old Skyrim.
Oh, I don't even think this. I could even see this far in the PC version.
Right, here we go.
Hooray!
Thank you for listening to my Skyrim ramblings.
And thank you for listening to First Chair Fantasy. And we'll speak to you again soon.
Bye. Goodbye!
Bye.
I didn't make it very far.
This podcast and others like it is made possible thanks to our wonderful backers on Patreon. To support Big Pudge Studios as we make comics like Afterlife Inc. and Seven String, games like Sandwich Masters, and podcasts like the one you've just been listening to, head on over to www.patreon.com/bigpunchstudios. This has been a Big Punch Studios production. For all things Big Punch, be sure to head over to www.bigpunchstudios.com.